Macmillan Audio presents The Other Olympians, Fascism, Queerness, and the Making of Modern Sports by Michael Waters. Read for you by Jennifer Pickens. A note on names, identities, and pronouns. The Other Olympians chronicles the lives of several European athletes, Zdeněk Kobek, Mark Weston, Vili de Bruin, and Witold Smentek, who publicly transitioned gender in the 1930s. Though all were assigned female at birth and were perceived by the public as women throughout their athletic careers, I refer to all using only male pronouns and only the names they chose after transitioning, in accordance with their publicly expressed identities and with the best practices outlined by the Trans Journalists Association. At a few junctures, you might see me quote from 1930s sources that include the name Kobkova, that is Kobek's feminized last name, since in Czech even last names are gendered. It is tempting to place a contemporary label like trans or intersex onto these athletes, but I try to use these labels sparingly throughout the book. It is difficult to fit any of them into a contemporary identity category. Today, many people understand that sex and gender are two separate categories. Gender is a psychological and socialized identity, while sex is assigned, often at birth, based on your physical body. But in the 1920s and 1930s, people did not differentiate between gender and sex as we do today. Though you can find allusions in the archives to a psychological or social understanding of gender, when writers talked about being a man, a woman, or an invert, they were generally referring to biological sex rather than to a social understanding of gender. A few times, I allude to Kobek and Weston as approximating trans identity, because both men, at various points, described their connection to maleness in psychological terms. In these moments, I am using trans broadly as an umbrella term to capture a number of different possible identities. Any portrait of each man's identity is muddled, however, by that lack of delineation between sex and gender. To receive gender-affirmative surgery, Kobek and Weston each needed to emphasize their normatively masculine physical traits, both in public and to their doctors. If they simply said they felt a psychological connection to male identity, they probably would not have received health care. For this reason, news reports about both men suggest that they each had biological traits typically associated with both male and female sex categories. Perhaps today, either Kobek or Weston would have gravitated more toward a label like intersex, which refers to the possibility that they were born with a mix of traits traditionally demarcated as both male and female. It is difficult to know. When we discuss them today, we should leave some space for a multitude of possible identities. Glossary of Acronyms. In the early 20th century, a disparate series of organizations issued sports policies. Though I have tried to simplify the bureaucratic details of sports governance where possible throughout the Other Olympians, here are some key acronyms to keep in mind as you listen. AAU, Amateur Athletic Union, U.S.-based sports organization that oversees American track and field sports, a key constituency of the American Olympic Committee. CAAU, Czechoslovak Amateur Athletic Union, Czechoslovakia-based track and field organization, the Czech equivalent of the AAU. FSFI, Fédération Sportive Féminine Internationale, the sports organization started by Elise Milia, overseeing the Women's World Games. IAAF, International Amateur Athletic Federation, the governing body of track and field sports. In 2019, it rebranded as World Athletics. IOC, International Olympic Committee. Part 1. Triumph. Chapter 1. The day before the world changed, Carl Diem walked into Berlin's new sports stadium in high spirits. It was the morning of June 27, 1914, and Diem, a gangly 32-year-old, was there to visit Germany's pre-Olympic Games, a dress rehearsal for the forthcoming event. In 2 short years, athletes from across the United States and Europe would convene at the very same stadium for the real Olympic Games. Diem needed to make sure it was perfect. No one had a bigger stake in the 1916 Olympics than Diem. The previous October, German officials had appointed him secretary of the organizing committee for the Olympic Games, a coalition of politicians and athletic officials tasked with setting the schedule, venue, lodging, layout, and financing for the competitions. It was a high honor for someone so young, especially given Diem's unconventional background. As a teenager, following a short-lived career running track, he had dropped out of high school to write for newspapers. His critiques of Germany's weak athletic infrastructure drew the notice of the country's sporting elites. They elected him, at the age of 21, to serve on one of Germany's top sports organizations. A decade later, Diem was the face of the next Olympics. Since his appointment to the organizing committee, he had traveled across Germany, giving speeches to dubious sports officials about the need to prepare their teams for international competition. Germany was a gymnastics-focused country, with 3 times more gymnasts than any other type of athlete. But Diem wanted to make the country a real competitor in sports like track and field. The fresh-faced dropout was still distressed that at the 1912 Olympics, Germany had finished an embarrassing 5th in the national medal count. Diem delivered lectures in Hamburg, Frankfurt, and Cologne, courting politicians for money over high-end Rhine wines and champagne. At night, as trains whisked him from city to city, he stayed up late plotting out the finer details of the Olympics. And his efforts weren't limited to his home country. He took a steamboat to America, where he met with Woodrow Wilson and gifted the U.S. president a German sports pin. Later, he visited the headquarters of the International Olympic Committee in Paris and returned to Berlin with a grand plan to blanket Germany with sports fields and playgrounds. That Saturday, Diem's vision of an athletically elite Germany seemed to be arriving. Thousands of top athletes warmed up for track and field competitions. Germany's head of state, Kaiser Wilhelm II, studied the crowd from a canopied box seat. During the day's competition, the Kaiser's nephew proved the indisputable star. The 21-year-old prince cruised through the distance run and the weight-throwing competitions. The press loved the spectacle, which meant so did Diem. With the backing of the Kaiser, he was invincible. No one involved could have known it then, but that spot, that gleaming new Berlin sports stadium, would, 22 years later, become the setting for a turning point in world history. It would become synonymous with fascism and racial discrimination, with new heights in athletic achievement and a major leap forward in radio technology, with propaganda and spectacle and social control, and, more quietly, with the birth of a regime of gender surveillance in sports. In 22 years, the fates of a loose group of sports professionals, a Czech athlete who publicly transitioned gender, the organizer of a breakaway sports competition for women, a closeted queer Missourian sprinter, an ambitious American executive, a Nazi sports doctor, an aging half-Jewish bureaucrat, and Diem himself, would all collide here during one of the most notorious Olympic Games in history. The result would be the creation of an Olympic sex testing policy and apparatus that, even as its origins have been forgotten, continues to define sports and, to an extent, society today. Once upon a time, this place was a patchwork of trees. In the second half of the 19th century, the population of Berlin, one of the largest cities in the newly formed German Empire, was exploding. The city's elites demanded more space, more fresh air, and more distance from the bustle and grime of the inner city. And so they turned to the massive Grunewald forest on the western edge of Berlin. Packed with conifers and birch trees, the Grunewald had, for centuries, hosted Prussian aristocrats looking to hunt wild boar and deer. Now, rich Berliners wanted to make it their new home. On the outskirts of the forest, they erected ungainly mansions, often over the protests of environmentalists, who in turn organized a Berlin Forest Protection Day to stop the development. They popularized a song that criticized the clearing of the Grunewald as a wood auction. But opposing the development was futile. Around 1909, the new neighborhood drew the attention of a small group of German officials who were looking to build a stadium big enough to host the Olympics. These officials fixated on a grassy area just outside the forest, which had everything they needed. A mostly undeveloped area not far from downtown Berlin, populated by residents rich enough to subsidize the construction. The German stadium, or Deutsches Stadion, opened in 1913 after a furious 200 days of work. It was the second largest sports venue in the world, home to a track, two gymnastics fields, a soccer field, a bicycling course, and a swimming pool. The German stadium was the stuff of dreams, a symbol of its country's new athletic prowess. Tourists flocked to it, and athletes battled to compete inside it. Carl Diem later bragged that in those days, there was life from morning to night at the stadium. When the Olympics came to town, he assumed, the German stadium would blow away the world. Sunday, June 28, 1914, was the second and last day of the pre-Olympic competition at the German stadium. In the morning, sharpshooters filed onto the field for the shooting championships. Between rounds, marching music blared throughout the stadium. At around 11:30 in the morning, the German shooters were preparing for the end of the competition when suddenly the music stopped. The black, red, and white flag of the German Empire dropped to half-mast. The breaking news was hard to believe. A young Serbian revolutionary had killed Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir to the Austro-Hungarian Empire and a close ally of the German state. Sitting in the audience, one German official, a Prussian general, reacted immediately. Diem recalled a single sentence. "This means war." It did, in fact, mean war. But it would take an agonizing few weeks to get there. Exactly 1 month later, on July 28th, the Austro-Hungarian Empire declared war on Serbia, activating a web of geopolitical alliances. 2 days after that, Russia mobilized against the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Germany, a dutiful ally of Austria-Hungary, declared war on Russia, then on France, then on Belgium. On August 4th, Britain launched its forces against Germany. Germany's Olympic dreams unraveled. Diem enlisted to fight in the German army that August, hoping for a swift end to the hostilities. He told reporters he would wait to send out invitations to the 1916 Olympics until there was peace. "We can be reasonably sure that modern war will not last so long," he said. But it wasn't meant to be. On October 1st, German officials dissolved the organizing committee and suspended all events at the German stadium. Instead, sheep grazed on the neglected field. The following April, when German soldiers deployed chlorine gas at Ypres, Belgium, the war entered a gruesome new phase. The 1916 Games were canceled. When the dust settled in the final days of 1918, Germany had not just lost the war, but also found itself expelled from nearly all global institutions, including the International Olympic Committee. Diem, a true believer in the Olympic project, was crushed. It was going to be a long road back. Chapter 2. Zdeněk Kobek grew up hearing whispers of independence. Born on December 8, 1913, in the Czech city of Paskov, a snow-covered village along the southeastern border with Poland.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.